is my beat. I make my living from it. I form my professional reputation on it. I treat it with the passion and precision of an undertaker. Somber and sympathetic about it when I'm with the bereaved, a skilled craftsman with it when I'm alone. I've always thought the secret of dealing with death was to keep it at arm's length. That's the rule. Don't let it breathe in your face. But my rule didn't protect me. When the two detectives came for me and told me about Sean, a cold numbness quickly enveloped me. It was like I was on the other side of the aquarium window. I moved as if underwater, back and forth, and looked out at the rest of the world through the glass. From the backseat of their car, I could see my eyes in the rearview mirror flashing each time we passed beneath a streetlight. I recognized the thousand-yard stare I had seen in the eyes of fresh widows I had interviewed over the years. I knew only one of the two detectives, Harold Wexler. I had met him a few months earlier when I stopped into the Pints of for a drink with Sean. They worked CAPs together on the Denver PD. I remember Sean called him Wex. Cops always use nicknames for each other. Wexler's is Wex, Sean's was Mac. Some kind of tribal bonding thing. Some of the names aren't complimentary, but the cops don't complain. I know one down in Colorado Springs named Scoto, who most other cops call Scroto. Some even go all the way and call him Scrotum, but my guess is that you have to be a close friend to get away with that. Wexler was built like a small bull, powerful but squat, a voice slowly cured over the years by cigarette smoke and whiskey, a hatchet face that seemed always red the times I saw him. I remember he drank Jim Beam over ice. I'm always interested in what cops drink. It tells a lot about them. When they're taking it straight like that, I always think that maybe they've seen too many things too many times that most people never even see once. Sean was drinking light beer that night, but he was young. Even though he was the soup of the CAP's unit, he was at least 10 years younger than Wexler. Maybe in 10 years he would have been taking his medicine cold and straight like Wexler. But now I'll never know. I spent most of the drive out from Denver thinking about that night at the Pints of. Not anything important that had happened. It was just drinks with my brother and the cop. It was just drinks with my brother at the cop bar. And it was the last good time between us before Teresa Lofton came up. That memory put me back in the aquarium. But during the moments when reality was able to punch through the glass and into my heart, I was seized by a feeling of failure and grief. It was the first real tearing of the soul I had experienced in my 34 years, and that included the death of my sister. I was too young then to properly grieve for Sarah or even understand the pain of a life unfulfilled. I grieve now because I had not even known Sean was so close to the edge. He was light beer while all the other cops I knew were risky on the rocks. Of course, I also recognized how self-pitying this kind of grief was. The truth was that for a long time we hadn't listened to each other. We had taken different paths, and each time I acknowledged this truth, the cycle of my grief would begin again. My brother once told me the theory of a limit. He said every homicide cop had a limit, but the limit was unknown until it was reached. He was talking about dead bodies. Sean believed that there were just so many that a cop could look at. It was a different number for every person. Some hit it early, some put in 20 in homicide and never got close, but there was a number. And when it came up, that was it. You transferred to records, you turned in your badge, you did something, because you just couldn't look at another one. And if you did, if you exceeded your limit, well, then you were in trouble. You might end up sucking down a bullet. That's what Sean said. I realized that the other one, Ray St. Louis, had said something to me. He turned around in his seat to look back at me. He was much larger than Wexler. Even in the dim light of the car, I could make out the rough texture of his pockmarked face. I didn't know him, but I'd heard him referred to by other cops, and I knew they called him Big Dog. I had thought he and Wexler made the perfect Mutt and Jeff team when I first saw them waiting for me in the lobby at the Rocky. It was like they had stepped out of a late-night movie. Long, dark overcoats, hats. The whole scene should have been in black and white. You hear me, Jack? We'll break it to her. That's our job. But we'd just like you to be there to sort of help us out. Maybe stay with her if it gets rough. You know? If she needs to be with somebody. Okay? Okay. Good, Jack. We were going to Sean's house. Not the apartment he split with four other cops in Denver, so in accordance with city regs, he was a Denver resident. His house in Boulder, where his wife Riley would answer our knock. I knew nobody was going to be breaking anything to her. She knew. She'd know what the news was the moment she opened the door and saw the three of us standing there without Sean. Any cop's wife would know. They spend their lives dreading and preparing for that day. Every time there's a knock on the door, they expect it to be death's messenger standing there when they open it. This time it would be. You know, she's going to know, I told them. Probably. They always do. I realized they were counting on Riley knowing the score as soon as she opened the door. It would make their job easier. I dropped my chin to my chest and brought my finger up beneath my glasses to pinch the bridge of my nose. I realized I'd become a character in one of my own stories, exhibiting the details of grief and loss I worked so hard to get so I could make a 30-inch newspaper story seem meaningful. Now I was one of the details in this story. A sense of shame descended on me as I thought of all the calls I had made to a widow or a parent or a dead child, or brother of a suicide. Yes, I'd even made those. I don't think there was any kind of death that I hadn't written about. It hadn't brought me around as the intruder into somebody's pain. How do you feel? Trusty words for a reporter. Always the first question. If not so direct, then carefully camouflaged in words meant to impart sympathy and understanding. Feelings I didn't actually have. I carried a reminder of this callousness. A thin white scar running along my left cheek just above the line of my beard. It was from the diamond engagement ring of a woman whose fiancé had been killed in an avalanche near Breckenridge. I asked her the old standby, and she responded with a backhand across my face. At the time, I was new to the job and thought I'd been wronged. Now I wear the scar like a badge. You better pull over. I'm gonna be sick. Wexler jerked the car into the freeway's breakdown lane. We skidded a little on the black ice, but then he got control. Before the car had completely stopped, I tried desperately to open the door, but the handle wouldn't work. It was a detective car, I realized, and the passengers who most often rode in the back were suspects and prisoners. The back door said security locks controlled from the front. The door, I managed to strangle out. The car finally jerked to a stop as Wexler disengaged the security lock. I opened the door, leaned out, and vomited into the dirty slush, three great heaves from the gut. For a half minute, I didn't move, waiting for more, but that was it. It was empty. I thought about the back seat of the car, for prisoners and suspects. And I guess that I was both now, suspect as a brother, and a prisoner of my own pride. The sentence, of course, would now be life. Those thoughts quickly slipped away with the relief of the physical exorcism. I gingerly stepped out of the car and walked to the edge of the asphalt where the light from the passing cars reflected in the moving rainbows on the petroleum exhaust glaze on the February snow. It looked as if we had stopped alongside a grazing meadow, but I didn't know where. I hadn't been paying attention to how far along the boulder we were. I took off my gloves and glasses and put them in the pockets of my coat. Then I reached down and dug beneath the spoiled surface to where the snow was white and pure. I took two handfuls of the cold, clean powder and pressed it to my face, rubbing my skin till it stung. You okay? He'd come up behind me with this stupid question. It was up there with, how do you feel? I ignored it. Let's go, I said. We got back in and Wexler wordlessly pulled the car back onto the freeway. I saw a sign for the Broomfield exit and knew we were about halfway there. Growing up in Boulder, I'd made the 30-mile run between there and Denver 1,000 times, but the stretch seemed like an alien territory to me now. For the first time, I thought of my parents and how they would deal with this. Stoically, I decided. They handled everything that way. They never discussed it. They moved on. They did it with Sarah. Now they do it with Sean. Why'd he do it? I asked after a few minutes. Wexler in St. Louis said nothing. And his brother. We're twins, for Christ's sake. You're also a reporter, St. Louis said. We picked you up because we want Riley to be with family if she needs it. The only... My brother fucking killed himself. I said it too loud. It had a quality of hysteria to it that I knew never worked with cops. You start yelling and they have a way of shutting down, getting cold. I continued in a subdued voice. I think I am entitled to know what happened and why. I'm not writing a fucking story. Jesus, you guys. I tried, I thought I would lose it again. I gazed out the window and could see the lights of Boulder coming up. So many more than when I was a kid. We don't know why. Okay? All I can say is that it happens. Sometimes cops get tired of all the shit that comes down the pipe. Mac would have gotten tired. That's all. Who knows? But they're working on it. And when they know, and I'll tell you. That's a promise. Who's they? The Park Service has turned it over to our department. SIU is handling it. Do you mean special investigations? They don't handle cop suicides. Normally they don't. We do. CAPs, but this time it's just that they're not going to let us investigate our own conflict of interest, you know. CAPs, I thought. Crimes against persons. Homicide, assault, rape, suicide. I wonder who would be listed in the reports as the person against whom this crime had been committed. Riley? Me? My parents? My brother? It was because of Teresa Lofton, wasn't it? It wasn't really a question. I didn't feel I needed their confirmation or denial. I was just saying out loud what I believed to be the obvious. We don't know Jack, St. Louis said. Let's leave it at that for now. The death of Teresa Lofton was the kind of murder that gave people pause. Not just in Denver, but everywhere. Made anybody who heard or read about it stop for at least a moment to consider the violent images it conjured in the mind, the twist it caused in the gut. Most homicides are little murders. That's what we call them in the newspaper business. Their effect on others is limited, their grasp on the imagination is short-lived. They get a few paragraphs on the inside pages, buried in the paper the way the victims are buried in the ground. But when an attractive college student is found in two pieces in a theretofore peaceful place like Washington Park, there usually isn't enough space in the paper for all the inches of copy it will generate. Teresa Lofton's was no little murder. It was a magnet that pulled at reporters from across the country. Teresa Lofton was the girl in two pieces. That was the catchy thing about this one. And so they descended on Denver from places like New York and Chicago and Los Angeles, television, tabloid, and newspaper reporters alike. For a week, they stayed at hotels with good room service, roamed the city and the University of Denver campus, asked meaningless questions and got meaningless answers. Some staked out the daycare center where Lofton had worked out part-time, went up to Butte, where she had come from. Wherever they went, they learned the same thing. Teresa Lofton fit that most exclusive media image of all, the all-American girl. The Teresa Lofton murder was inevitably compared to the Black Dahlia case of 50 years ago in Los Angeles. In that case, a not-so-all-American girl was found severed at the midriff in an empty lot. A tabloid television show dubbed Teresa Lofton the White Dahlia, playing on the fact that she had been found on a snow-covered field near Denver's Lake Grasmere. And so the story fed on itself. It burned as hot as a trash can fire for almost 2 weeks, but nobody was arrested and there were other crimes, other fires for the national media to warm itself by. Updates on the Lofton case dropped back into the inside pages of the Colorado papers. They became briefs for the digest pages. And Teresa Lofton finally took her spot among the little murders. She was buried. All the while, the police in general and my brother in particular remained virtually mute, refusing even to confirm the detail that the victim had been found in two parts. That report had come only by accident from a photographer at the Rocky named Iggy Gomez. He had been in the park looking for wild art, the feature photos that fill the pages on a slow news day. When he happened upon the crime scene ahead of any other reporters or photographers, the cops had made the call-outs to the coroners and crime scene offices by landline since they knew the Rocky and the Post monitored their radio frequencies. Gomez took shots of two stretchers being used to remove two body bags. He called the city desk and said the cops were working a two-bagger, and from the looks on the side of the bags, the victims were probably children. Later, a cop shop reporter from the Rocky, named Van Jackson, got a source in the coroner's office to confirm the grim fact that the victim had come into the morgue in two parts. The next morning's story in the Rocky served as the siren call to the news media across the country. My brother and his CAP's team worked as if they felt an obligation. My brother and his CAP's team worked as if they felt no obligation to talk to the public at all. Each day, the Denver Police Department media office put out the scant few lines in a press release announcing that the investigation was continuing and that there had been no arrests. When cornered, the brass vowed that the case would not be investigated in the media, though that in itself was a laughable statement. Left with little information from the authorities, the media did what it always does in such cases. It investigated the case on its own, numbing the reading and television-watching public with assorted details about the victim's life that actually had nothing to do with anything. Still, almost nothing leaked from inside the department. Little was known outside headquarters on Delaware Street. And after a couple of weeks, the media onslaught was over, strangled by the lack of its lifeblood, information. I didn't write about Teresa Lofton, but I wanted to. It wasn't the kind of story that comes along often in this place, and any reporter would have wanted a piece of it. But at first, Van Jackson worked it with Laura Fitzgibbons, the university beat reporter. I had to bide my time. I knew that as long as the cops didn't clear it, I'd get my shot at it. So when Jackson asked me in the early days of the case if I would get anything from my brother, even off the record, I told him I would, but I didn't try. I wanted the story, and I wasn't going to help Jackson stay on it by feeding him from my source. In late January, when the case was a month old and it dropped out of the news, I made my move, and my mistake. One morning, I went in to see Greg Glenn, the city editor, and told him I'd like to do a takeout of the Lofton case. That was my specialty, my beat. Long takes on the notable murders of the Rocky Mountain Empire. To use a newspaper cliche, my expertise was going behind the headlines to bring you the real story. So I went to Glenn and reminded him I had an in. It was my brother's case, I said, and he'd only talk to me about it. Glenn didn't hesitate to consider the time, and effort Jackson had already put into the story, I knew that he wouldn't. All he cared about was getting a story on the Post. It was my brother's case, I said, and he'd only talk to me about it. Glenn didn't hesitate to consider the time and effort Jackson had already put on the story. I knew that he wouldn't. All he cared about was getting a story the Post didn't have. I walked out of the office with my assignment. The mistake was that I told Glenn I had the in before I had talked to my brother. The next day, I walked the two blocks from the Rocky to the cop shop and met him for lunch in the cafeteria. I told him about my assignment. Sean told me to turn around. Go back, Jack. I can't help you. What are you talking about? It's your case. It's my case, but I'm not cooperating with you or anybody else who wants to write about it. I've given the basic details. That's all I'm required to do. That is where it stays. He looked up across the cafeteria. He had an annoying habit of not looking at you when you disagreed with him. When we were little, I would jump on him when he did it and punch him on the back. I didn't do it that anymore, though, many times I wanted to. Sean, this is a good story. I don't have to do anything, and I don't give a shit what kind of story it is. This one is bad, Jack, okay? I can't stop thinking about it, and I'm not going to help you sell newspapers with it. Come on, man. I'm a writer. Look at me. I don't care if it sells papers or not. The story is the thing. I don't give a shit about the paper. You know how I feel about that. He finally turned back to me. Now you know how I feel about this case. I was silent a moment and took out a cigarette. I was down to maybe half a pack a day back then and could have skipped it, but I knew it bothered him. So I smoked when I wanted to work on him. This isn't a smoking section, Jack. Then turn me in. At least you'll be arresting somebody. Why are you such an asshole when you don't get what you want? Why are you? You aren't going to clear it, are you? That's what this is all about. You don't want me digging around and writing about your failure. You're giving up. Jack, don't try the below-the-belt shit. You know it's never worked. Jack, don't try the below-the-belt shit. You know it's never worked. He was right. It never had. And what? You just want to keep this little horror story to yourself? Is that it? Yeah, something like that. You could say that.